Yeah, thanks a lot for the introduction. And yeah, my topic is somewhat less related to plant sciences, but yeah, I would like to introduce a little bit what my group is doing in the Computer Science Institute next door. Which is about autonomous intelligent systems, and here in particular about mobile robots and perception and planning for these. And as you might guess, there is a ton of new application areas for robots. Yeah, so not just industrial mass production, but of course agriculture, and many other fields, including self-driving cars or even toys. But to make that work, we need more cognitive abilities than current robots have. And there is multiple sub-problems to solve, including perceiving the environment through all kinds of sensors to build a model that is suitable for planning the action, and then of course we also need to carry them out and influence the environment in particular ways. And the interesting thing about robotics is maybe as opposed to machine learning, where you just look at canned data sets, there is this loop closed. Yeah, so whatever you do will influence your next measurement, and in this cycle you need to learn and need to plan your next action. So we developed multiple robotic systems for complex demonstration scenarios, robots that are equipped with a lot of sensors and actuators to carry out particular tasks like playing soccer or assisting people in everyday environments, or mobile manipulation in areas where you don't want to send or cannot send a human, bin picking or aerial inspection. And I would like to introduce some of these to you. Here you see two domestic service robots that we developed for the RoboCup at home competitions. So there is not just soccer in RoboCup, but also competitions for assisting people in everyday environments, and of course you have to develop a robot there that is small enough to navigate in these space-restricted environments and that can manipulate objects and interact with people. Here you see our robot Cosero at the competition that was in Eindhoven. So there is annual world championships, and of course this robot has to build a map of the environment. This is done by registering laser scans and then modeling the environment, for example, as a 2D grid map. And if you have such a representation, then you can find navigation plans to go from A to B. The robot is also equipped with a Kinect camera, so that not just makes color images, but can also estimate depth for most of the pixels. And we developed simple methods to fit a plane that supports the objects, and then see what is sticking out of that plane, modeling individual clusters, and testing different kinds of grass to then flexibly grasp many unknown objects, as long as they are not too small or not too big and accessible. But the robot is also equipped with a tiltable laser scanner, so we can, from different points of view, capture 3D scans of the environment, register them, and then in this work we model in voxels the point distribution with surface elements, so that we can aggregate the data and estimate, for example, also surface normals. And from such representations, we can then build nice 3D maps that assess drivability. For example, this open window here would not be represented well in a 2D map, but is judged as non-drivable in this 3D representation. Of course, the sensors like a Kinect camera have a quite high data rate, and it is somewhat challenging to process this data in real time. But Jörg Stückler in my group developed methods that are very efficient for registering this data just with the CPU. And the core idea is, again, this multi-resolution surface representation that is high resolution close to the sensor and coarser resolution further away. And it does not just model the geometry, but also color distribution within the voxels. Yeah? So we can register this data as the sensor moves, and also globally optimize the registration error to come up with consistent models of environments. We also looked at multiple of these cameras looking simultaneously in different directions, and then we can model the environment without moving the sensor so much. But you can also move the sensor around objects, and then by registering and fusing these measurements create 3D object models with also color distributions that then can be used in real time to register the model with the current data, which means we estimate the poles of this object, and then the robot can, for example, grasp this watering can or this chair and manipulate it in some way. But yeah, so far we made the assumption that there is a rigid transformation between the model and the data that we may have. But by dropping this assumption and allowing for non-rigidity or deformable registration, then we can find correspondences maybe between different articulation states of the same object or between objects of different shape or color. And this then can be used to transfer manipulation knowledge. Yeah? So in this case, we define the usage of a watering can with respect to the known green watering can. But in this demonstration that was at the competition in Eindhoven, there were multiple watering cans that were not modeled, so unknown to the robot. But by establishing these correspondences between the known model and this unknown object of different color and shape, we can transform the manipulation skills and use it. We also looked a little bit at tool use. Yeah, so here in this demonstration, the robot grasped the bottle opener and the bottle. Also, yeah, depth information is used to estimate the tooltip and bottle tip to calibrate away the inaccuracies of the hardware. And of course, the beer needs to be delivered to a jury member to convince them. We always, it's difficult to judge, of course, these kind of demonstrations. Yeah, so there is a subjective component of the jury, and we always try to make the jury happy by providing some beer or food to them. And we were actually quite successful there because we won the international competition in RoboCup at home 3 times in a row, and also the European Championship actually 4 times in a row. But in a small European project, we use the same robot for a little bit more serious application like bin picking. So the assumption is that there is known objects in a transport box, but randomly placed in a pile. And the objects are modeled with three-dimensional or two-dimensional shape primitives, which we then can detect in 3D measurements of that pile and instantiate multiple of these object models, which is then the basis for planning first in an offline phase and then according to the perceived situation, the grasping motion of the robot. And I think this was the first mobile bin picking robots. At least nobody challenged that claim so far. But of course, bin picking is one of the classical problems in robotics. Yeah, here the robot also can then deliver the picked part. We also looked a bit at how things move. Yeah, so if you drop the assumption that the scene is static, but make the assumption that it consists of multiple parts that are rigid but move with particular speeds, then you can model them separately and segment the scene into motion segments, but also things that move together somehow also belong together. And by observing the common motion, you can observe a segment hierarchy, for example, then knowing that this drawer moves relative to the container, and then together they move relative to the entire room, which is the background here. Just seeing the geometry or color distribution, of course, is not enough. You want to recognize certain things. For example, categorize pixels, in this case, with random forests. And the interesting thing here is now that we do it from multiple perspectives as the camera moves and aggregate this information in 3D, because we can estimate the camera motion by means of this SLAM methods, and then back project these aggregated in 3D semantic maps. And this works better than looking at individual views. But of course, in recent years, deep learning is very popular, and everyone is using these techniques. And the core idea here is to learn hierarchical layers of representation. Yeah? To first explain your measurement, like pixels, in terms of simple features that then are combined to more and more complex features. And this might be a good idea if the world has these properties. Yeah? So if there is hierarchical structure, or neighboring elements have more to do with each other than far apart ones. And if you then make pictures of such environments, then this kind of assumption that underlies this approach is justified and works quite well. But actually, these methods are not so new. A long time ago, during my PhD, I was also looking at very similar systems. And the interesting part here is that I did not just look at this bottom-up flow of information that extracts features, but also considered two other ways of information flow, like top-down expansion of feature or synthesis of lower levels, and also the interaction of neighboring elements on the same level of description, with the key idea being that there might always be local ambiguities where you cannot easily interpret the data, but you may start at the easy parts first and then use these cycles to provide more and more contextual information for iteratively resolving these ambiguities. And of course, you can also process sequences of images and then recursively estimate a state, integrate information over time. In this example of Mircea Pavel, with the goal of semantic segmentation, meaning every pixel is assigned a category in this environment. And depth often helps. Yeah? So if we just have images, then it may not be so easy to interpret them, but if you have depth measurements, we can, for example, compute here additional features that help the interpretation, like the distance from the closest wall. So if some object is sticking out, then this may be a segmentation hint. And another thing is here that small robotic data sets may not be sufficient to just learn from them. But if you also use features that are learned on internet scale data sets that are related, then this might be a good starting point for further training. And this kind of transfer learning is very successful for these kind of small data sets. Yeah, that approach was also used in this work, which was actually the bachelor thesis of Marc Schwarz. So we use a pre-trained convolutional neural network and feed it images of objects on a turntable, but also pre-processed depth measurements that are represented as three color channels and then fed into that network, so that we get a 10,000 dimensional representation here, which can be used then for categorization of the objects, for recognizing instances, or for estimating their pose. This depth pre-processing can make use of 3D information to normalize away a certain variability, in this case the elevation of the camera. So we render the object from a canonical point of view and colorize it with an object-based representation. So we estimate where its central vertical axis is, and according to the distance then we use color. And the interesting part here is that the original data lives in very high dimensional spaces and might be highly entangled. Yeah. And these pre-trained neural networks, they project the data into 10,000 dimensional spaces, which are hard to see, but if you back project them to two dimensions, you can really see that the different classes are much better separated than the traditional computer vision features. Yeah? So somehow the data got disentangled and is then easier to interpret. Yeah? Similarly, if you focus on one particular class, instances are separated and the different viewing angles onto an object, they form a nice manifold, which then makes it easier to recognize the things or estimate their pose, also from very few data. And here are some of the examples where the approach failed. Yeah, so they are also kind of similar. In the year 2015, motivated by the DARPA Robotics Challenge, we developed this robot that we call Momaru. It kind of combines different features that we had before, like an anthropomorphic upper body and also wheels that are steerable, but also legs to address not a single task, but multiple tasks that were posed by DARPA, like driving this kind of vehicle getting out of the vehicle. This takes some seconds, so I somehow skipped part of the video. But it's really nice that the robot can make steps to overcome these height differences. We developed some user interfaces for teleoperation of the robot, like here an immersive visualization and tracking of the hands for a particular manipulation tasks, also for the navigation, there are teleoperation interfaces. So, the next task after getting out of the car was actually opening and going through a door. And here you go. We have this rotating laser scanner on the robot and can build first, egocentric representations of these environments, for example, for this visualization. Of course, we have to take into account that objects move, like this open door is then removed again from the maps, but we can also globally register the data to build nice allocentric models of the environment. Yeah, here's the user interface for the next task that is turning this valve, and the robot did it. There were also tasks that were unknown in advance. So every day there was a new so-called surprise task. So for example, operating the switch or pulling a plug and putting it back into another socket. and some also locomotion tasks that were a bit challenging, like overcoming this pile of debris. Actually, we were prepared to grasp heavy objects and throw them out, but somehow that was not necessary, and the robot could just bulldoze through this pile of debris. Maybe the most interesting manipulation task was using a tool. Yeah, so one could choose which tool that was provided was used, and the robot had to grasp it and to switch it on. And then cut a hole into this drywall. So this was the actual task. In the interest of time, I may also skip parts of this video. So at the end, there is a hole. Yeah, overall, we solved 7 of the 8 tasks much quicker than everyone else. But we were not brave enough to do the stair climbing. Actually, the next day we had a different stair climbing behavior, but then we failed to get out of the car because the stair climbing was triggered when we wanted to go out of the car. Anyhow, the DARPA robotics challenge was not so much about autonomy, but at the same year, DLR posed an interesting challenge that they call Spaceport Cup, so in a Mars-like environment, without teleoperation, so in a supervised autonomy mode where you can configure your robot and supervise it from a distance, but actually you cannot influence what the robot is doing except for very few communication slots. The robot had to take this soil sample and find this yellow brick that is supposed to be a battery pack, and then put the soil on the scale, switch the thing on, insert the battery pack, and that worked quite well. And you see here some of the representations built, like a 3D map of the environment, some task specification on a high level, but also the perception of the objects and then the grasping of these. Yeah. So as the task goes on, the model of the environment is more and more complete so that we can make better and better plans. Same mapping method applied to our lab, where you can easily see some difficulties for the locomotion. And in the meanwhile, this robot got a new sensor that has a higher data rate and longer range so that we can build nice maps of somewhat larger environments, like the backyard of our institute building, former institute building. But based on such representations, plans for locomotion are made. For example, here, considering also the concrete footprint of the robot, so that the robot can also take obstacles between its wheels or make steps if necessary, and then somewhat complex manipulation challenges can be attempted, like climbing the stairs here, even though there is an additional obstacle where the robot needs to drive sideways, which would be difficult for tracked robots, for example. And similar methods have been further developed in the European project, which I coordinated, called Centauro. The robot was built by the Italian Institute of Technology, also in Pisa. An exoskeleton was developed for also force feedback and teleoperation of the robot. The scenarios were also similar. Go where you cannot send easily a human, so these evaluations have been done at the Kerntechnische Hilfsdienst in Karlsruhe. So these are the rescue forces for nuclear power plants in Germany. And different kinds of locomotion or manipulation tasks have been tested there. Like here, also overcoming a step field by means of driving and making steps. The terrain has been categorized, and Tobias Klamt in my group developed a hierarchical approach for planning, where we represent the environment coarser and coarser the further it is away. but also abstract away many features of the robot and then describe abstract actions like climbing stairs or so, which significantly accelerates planning in larger environments. And with regards to perception, yeah, deep learning is used, for example, to detect tools in yeah, disaster areas like our mechatronic workshop, and to segment the pictures in terms of pixels. Also, yeah, with the more recent RefineNet approach. And the challenge here often is data. Yeah, to get enough data to be able to train these networks. And yeah, one of the possibilities is generating data. Yeah, maybe synthesizing complex scenes like these by inserting novel objects. And of course, improving generalization is also one way to address this problem, for example, by having object models that are object-centered by means of transfer learning or self-supervised learning or all kinds of other techniques. Yeah? So we capture objects on turntables, render these scenes, and then within a few minutes, the system can then also interpret such complex bin scenes with the new trained objects, which is then used for generating grass in the Amazon Robotics Challenge, for example, or estimate object poses by focusing on individual objects and then registering these with the data. But we can also generate highly detailed 3D textured models of objects from these turntable views. Generalization, of course, is not just important for the perception, but also for the action side of things. And towards this goal, we, for example, model the shape difference to a canonical model of an object category, and then learn the principal axis of the shape of this category. And this then allows us to interpolate between different shapes and maybe even extrapolate. And then to register this learned shape with partial views of the data. Yeah, so we have unknown objects, and then we can not just register in a rigid way, but in that learned shape space, and by this also estimating the parameters, is this a particularly tall power drill or a short one or I don't know what, and then yeah, have control points for example, the grasping action and transfer this manipulation knowledge to unknown instances that the robot never saw before. And then, yeah, hopefully also use these tools. So this is again teleoperation in the evaluation of this Centauro project. But of course, the robot also has two arms. So we looked a bit, little bit at bimanual manipulation. Like here, we transferred this grasping approach also to an object with two handles, and. Can then use that for yeah, by manual drilling in this example. And yeah, maybe one of the more challenging manipulation tasks or manipulation and locomotion tasks actually was to use a key to open a door and then of course yeah go through that and enter the next room. Or here. Yeah, a shackle was attached to a ring, and this also was quite a challenge with regards to manipulation or inserting a plug, also in a mobile end. Yeah, so this is clearly also only possible if you have two manipulators And yeah, in the final evaluation of this project, we also raised the bar with regards to the challenges of locomotion, for example, by having larger height differences and also throwing in some additional debris. This is autonomous locomotion, yeah, so the robot sees that there is this gravel and drives around in an omnidirectional way, and then also does a little bit of stair climbing. We not only look at ground-based robots, but also some flying vehicles. And actually, we started motivated by our colleagues from the agricultural department in the DFG research unit, mapping on demand. So this was the first copter that we developed. And the idea here is that different sensor modalities have different shortcomings, and we followed a multimodal approach with a 3D laser scanner that can see in all directions the obstacles and with the stereo cameras, for example, for estimating the motion of the vehicle, but also for seeing thin things like this wire here, and ultrasound for transparent obstacles like windows. Of course, one needs to compensate for the motion of the vehicle. It's like a rolling shutter with 1 second of time. And then, ecocentric representations of the environment are built in terms of local multi-resolution shovel maps. We can build allocentric representations, like here, the Gutshaus in Frankenforst. We looked at the action side of things by planning the mission using travel and salesman problems, allocentric planning, egocentric navigation planning, and with a high rate also reactive obstacle avoidance. And here you see some footage from the intermediate evaluation of this research unit, which convinced the reviewer. So the mission was to inspect here the gutter. As the robot flies, more and more measurements are made, and the map is completed. In the European robotics challenges, we developed this robot that also went to an environment where you may not want to send a human, namely inside a chimney. It inspected the wall, and we built high-resolution detailed representation of the inner surface in terms of the color and also depth differences, and then could also navigate towards things, towards locations that looked like defects, and inspect them even further. This is the platform that we use recently. It's a little bit bigger and equipped with this automotive laser scanner. This was, for example, used in an autonomy 4.0 project to inspect warehouses and find out where the goods are. And we built 3D maps of this environment, have obstacle avoidance, as you have seen, and have special sensors then to detect attacks for the goods and localize them in the shelves. Unfortunately, this sensor has a limited vertical field of view, but Matthias Nievenhäusen modified the path planning so that the robot flies only where it can see. And this results then in these kind of spiral patterns that are somewhat longer, but safe in the sense that the robot always measures where it flies. And if there should be unexpected obstacles, then it would see it. Yeah. We also improved the registration of the laser scans in recent work. So David Dröschel did that by more precisely registering and aligning these scans, very sharp representations of these environments can be built in terms of their 3D structure. And recently, we look also at a bit more applied area in a competence center for rescue robots. So we added a thermal camera and made some experiments in the Brandhaus in Dortmund, where you can make artificial fires and then build a 3D model of this environment in terms of a mesh that carries then textures for the color, but also for the temperature distribution. Yeah, so here you see this 3D mesh of this environment, and then also how these textures are incrementally built from the different modalities, and you can see easily things that may be difficult to observe with the naked eye in terms of this temperature camera. But of course, semantic is important, so we categorize the images, and the interesting aspect here is that we can leverage autonomous driving data set for the flying robot. Yeah, by aggregating the semantic categorization in the model and then back projecting it to other views, we can artificially generate training data and kind of lift that labels to novel views. So this is the build model. And yeah, you haven't seen a plan so far, so I have like two more slides on a project that my group is doing together with Andrea Schnepf on actually reconstructing plant roots from MRI measurements. And the issue here is that these measurements are relatively low resolution and low signal to noise. And we would like to increase contrast and resolution of these, but we have very few examples. Actually, for the initial work, only two usable examples were there. And also the manual reconstructions, which we potentially could use as ground truths, were not well aligned enough to do so. And our approach was to actually generate training data, yeah, to apply all kinds of geometric distortions to these reconstructions and various types of noise to blow up the data to several thousand examples, where we then can learn the semantic segmentation in super resolution with deep neural networks, and then apply the learned models to real data, which works quite well. And for example, makes it then easier to reconstruct the routes either manually, or we have also automated methods for that. So in conclusion, my group developed some capable robot systems for challenging scenarios. So I showed you domestic service robots, robots for disaster response, and aerial inspection robots. Our focus is on autonomy, and for this we need suitable perception, for example 3D mapping and also semantics, but also planning of navigation and manipulation. And yeah, how might this be relevant for Phanerob? Well, Cyril in his talk also said something like you can use it as a tool. Yeah, so whatever tasks you may have for a robot may require similar methods, and I see relevance in particular for the core project one, building like structural models of plants and describing their shape, but also having textures of maybe color or different modalities, maybe multi or hyperspectral data, or maybe also temperatures, or bump maps, or similar things. Also establishing correspondences between different points in time of the same plant, but possibly also with regards to core project four intervention, mainly also on the perceptual side. Of course, if you want the robot to do something, then you need to, for example, recognize where certain plant organs are, or where certain plants are that you want to treat in a particular way. Of course, that is challenging. Yeah. For example, establishing correspondences despite growth of the plant and a lot of deformation that may happen, I think is challenging. And yeah, that sounds a bit strange, small and big data, yeah, but I mentioned that we had to learn from two reconstructions of plants, which is much less than the usual models require. Yeah. Somehow you have to compensate for this lack of data and come up with very data efficient methods for learning. But on the other hand, if you imagine that your robot is equipped with a lot of sensors and they produce some gigabytes per minute and drives across the field for the entire day, then you may also have an issue with big data and need to handle these kind of data sets and process them, interpret them, build models. Yeah, so thank you.
So you mentioned the correspondence despite growth and deformations. You showed a very nice video somewhere in the middle where of your presentation where you have shown how the objects actually deform and how you then also can do registration where you can obviously partial objects, which look really nice. And my question was exactly this: how do you solve the correspondence problem in this context?
Yes. Yeah, so in the video of the marks that you may refer to, we first make the assumption that the mark comes from a particular category, marks. Yeah, okay? Of course, if we have a different category, we learn a new model of power drills or whatever. In this work, the deformation is kind of holistic, but we have some newer work, which I didn't include in this presentation, where we do this localized part-based. Okay? I think for plants, the structure is actually key. Yeah? So you have to model the structure of the plant organs and then in this system, kind of like an articulated model that people use, for example, for humans. Yeah? So we have also done some work in the past for articulated ICP, for example, modeling particular motion. And registering these kind of articulated models then with the data. In addition to this articulation structure is needed is a shape description, is highly detailed textures. For establishing correspondences, you need to recognize things, okay? So you need to, recognize this is a tip of a leaf. Of course, you would not associate a tip of a leaf with some other part of the plant. Yeah? There will also be multiple leaf tips, and maybe one leaf looks very similar to another one. Yeah? By having already a model of the structure and maybe also some idea on how the plant would continue to grow, our hope is that, spatial similarity will play a role, or similarity in terms of descriptors. Yeah, so maybe one leaf has a little defect, and if you find the same defect somewhere else, that could also be a hint for associating the data. The problem is not simple. There might be multiple hints for data association, and I put this here as one of the challenges. Yeah? So I think this is really also an interesting scientific challenge where one then can make distribution contributions, write interesting papers, and actually graduate. Yeah?
I have a general question. You showed a lot of videos which are, by the way, really impressive. What can be done by robots today? Actions which we also know from our daily life. But the robots are rather slow, at least from the human perspective. So my question is, what has to be done to improve that maybe in future robots can do that as fast and reliable as a human? Is it a problem of sensors? Is it a problem of the methods and algorithms in the back and computational power? Or a problem of the mechanics of the robot itself? In the beginning, you showed that pipeline with a loop closure.
So first of all, not all our robots are slow. I didn't show you all, but for example, about 2 years ago, we had a robot in Abu Dhabi at the robotics challenge, and this was driving like 15 kilometers per hour with an omnidirectional drive, and three times faster than everyone else solving a mobile manipulation task. I can dig out this video, but for this particular challenge, we focused on speed, and then the robot also was kind of quick, but. Of course, there is underlying reasons for robots sometimes being slow. Yeah? So my experience is that teleoperation actually is slow. Yeah? So if you do it in an autonomous way, then you can perform the task much quicker. But the variability of possible tasks that can be addressed is smaller. So you make certain assumptions if you want to control your robot in an autonomous way. And a human teleoperator does not need to make these assumptions and can bring in his or her background knowledge to solve a larger variability of tasks. Yeah? And of course, also with regards to autonomous action, there are certain latencies in the system. One can improve things, for example, by having quicker sensors. Yeah? So one of the reasons why we changed towards this automotive laser scanner is that it can scan with 10 hertz in all directions. Previously, we had this rotating laser scanner that would have just like 1 hertz. If we measure 10 times faster and are able to process the data on board, so we always have very strong onboard computers, then we can increase the speed. Similarly, also on the actuator side, if you, for example, want the speed, you need to have the proper motors. For example, for this Mario robot and in the mobile manipulation challenge in Abu Dhabi, we then use directly driven wheels that actually come from hoverboards, and they are quite quick, much quicker than the wheels we had before. There is maybe more interesting aspects of that question. For example, why are we so quick even though our information processing is kind of slow? Yeah? So there is a lot of latency in our visual system and also in the motor control on the order of several hundreds of milliseconds. Nevertheless, we can act quite quickly. And the reason is we can predict pretty well. Okay, so we use predictions to cancel latencies, and in quite old work, we actually have been using that approach to control small, weird robots that were really quick by playing soccer, actually. If you learn predictive models to cancel these latencies, then you can control them much quicker than if you have to kind of wait to account for the latency.
I just have a comment and a question about the interactions in FinaRob. In CP1, I know you're working with Ube, so it's important to realize two things, really. One thing that I think I see in FinaRob in a number of core projects is talking about individual plants. There are not really individual plants in cropping systems, particularly if we're going to focus on broadacre, barley, canola, sugar beet. It's plant stands, and there's actually already been a lot of work on phenotyping, modeling, and predicting individual leaf growth, tip growth, etc. But we really want to focus on the canopy, the stand growth, and I think you'll pick that up working with Uwe. The second thing I wanted to ask about CP4 intervention. So this is really interesting. And thinking specifically about fertilizer intervention, what I'm wondering about the robots generally is what is sort of their payload or weight? How much weight can they carry for how long distances? So let's say they have the task of checking out nitrogen status, and then they have to actually go and apply a nitrogen transformation inhibitor. How much stuff can they carry, and how long can they run around for?
Yeah, so maybe your first comment. From my point of view, we need to do both. So we in CP1, I aim at modeling individual plants. This might be more challenging for barley if at later growth stages, but for example, sugar beets, this might be easier for larger plants. There will of course also be sensor systems that measure larger areas from a somewhat larger distance, maybe flying robots or different large gantry. The focus is maybe more on the canopy. Okay, for example, Gabriel showed some images where you really need to look at sub-millimeter scales to recognize deficiencies of nitrogen, for example. And I aim at such high-resolution textured representations of the plant, so that, for example, in CP2, one can discover features that are not already known. Yeah? So if you have this kind of data set, by registering all these detailed measurements, then you can analyze these and then maybe find out that, I don't know, the roughness of the surface is a good predictor for this kind of disease or this kind of deficiency or maybe yield or whatever. Yeah? So I do think we need both. Yeah, but for example, if you have a brown spot on a leaf and would like to see how that develops over time, if you are able to model the same plant twice at different growth stages and establish this correspondence, then you can say, oh, this little spot developed and grew bigger in 3 days, and that's why I think there is an issue of whatever nature. Yeah, so. You may not need to know that, but I do think it provides the basis for discovering new features, things that you possibly do not know at this point. Okay. Second point, how much can it carry? This always depends on how you construct your robot. You can carry as much as you want, use a tractor, and call it a robot. Yeah, so.
Then I was not thinking about grain or wheat or maize. I was thinking about if I look in the early spring, I see a lot of farms. They have to hire workers to pick strawberries or whatever, and that costs money. That costs money. So, sorry. Yeah? Well, whatever. Strawberries in Spain, and whatever. And so that would be something where a farmer could say, I save 20,000, 30,000, 40,000 euros in labor if I have a robot can do the picking for me. Now the question is, you need to be fast. I don't know how many strawberries they have to pick in 1 hour, but that would be a lot. So how, when can we expect something in that direction that is operational, that is competitive with a human being? Is that within the 7 years of being a robot? And if we, you can put your other way around and say, how much money do you need to make it happen?
Yeah. So first of all, I think harvesting is a very interesting use case. Yeah. So also this asparagus was already mentioned today, but I don't see it being addressed in Phenolog. Yeah. So there's different use cases, of course the more valuable the work is, the more economic sense it may make to replace it by an automated system. And in terms of speed, this heavily depends on how specialized you develop your machine. Yeah? So many of our machines are kind of general purpose. Yeah? So they address not a single task, but all kinds of tasks. And if you address a particular purpose, you then can develop special purpose mechanisms, maybe for grasping the strawberry or for cutting it or whatever. And as automation shows in industrial mass production, it is possible to surpass humans in speed. Yeah? So also with delta arms, for example, they can move very quick if you want that. Yeah? You can also parallelize things. Yeah? For example, for picking cucumbers or so, you attach multiple humans to a tractor and have them dig out and pick the cucumbers, yeah. And of course, you can also attach like 10 cameras and 10 manipulators and pick cucumbers, yeah. So you can increase speed by means of parallelization. Yeah? But give a negative answer to your question, I don't see it as the objective of FinROP to really develop products in the sense of a practical application making money.
No, my point is, in which direction do you go and where is the largest potential? And if you ask me, I see the largest potential in the robots, not in the typical crops, but in high value fruit crops or so on, because there you need still labor, and if you want to replace labor, you can have benefits. I mean, there is always on the payload, you will always need a tractor. And you can say, I can automate a tractor and have a robot, that's fine with me. But I see it more in where can I save labor, if you think in potential for future markets. And this is also something you have to keep in mind if you do FinROP. Where is the potential for future markets, and how can we steer our research in that direction? And then I see it more in this more challenging activities.
Yeah, I have a similar question. What you as advanced is how we formulate it with respect to high value crops and saving labor, but already with the crops that we are growing in the entrepreneurial project or the cluster, we also talk about new field arrangements, we talk about the allocation of crops in the field, the allocation. At the moment we have the conventional row system. We can think of other systems of arranging plants in the field. And there's a great potential, theoretically, through such technologies to make that happen. At the moment, we are stick to the row system and the tractor system, but it's a compromise. It's because of the technical solution that was available. If we have new technical solutions, we wouldn't grow crops in rows, probably, because from ecological principles, that is not the best way of growing crops. For certain, weed competition issues, and disease issues, etc. So I was actually wanting to ask you the similar question, how far do you want to go in developing capable robotic systems in order to try out what is technically feasible and to see how that really works in the field?
Yeah, so from my point of view, this is also always a question of resources. Yeah? And as we all know, funding is limited, and even in the original proposal, we did not really address harvesting and developing very complex mechanisms that maybe steer around the individual plants. Yeah, so in principle, we can do that. But in practice, for example, this Centaur robot costs like $500,000. Yeah, so it's a complex machine, and it's highly flexible. But for such specialized tasks, one would probably develop much more specialized mechanisms that then solve the actual task. And from my point of view, it is already challenging, even though you may say, I have a modeling of individual plants on my turntable in my lab, to do similar things on the field, yeah, to maybe have a dome of different cameras observing a single plant on the field within a second, and then drive to the next plant, and after 10 seconds observe this one. Modeling not just a single plant, but maybe 1,000 on the field. Yeah? So the CP1 description says actually all plants. That may be challenging and not necessary. But if you model 1,000 plants, then this is already this kind of big data issue. And then you may apply much stronger statistics, but because, yeah, learning from a single example is very difficult, but if you have sufficient data, then yeah, you may, for example, discover new features that predict whatever you are interested in, yeah, diseases, deficiencies in certain nutrients, or whatever stress a plant may have. But Cyril also, yeah.
I just want to add to the discussion we had before regarding strawberries. I also think that strawberries are not necessarily a focus area here of Figaro. And in order to scale that up, you need to work especially on the actuation point of people with this. But just to give you a little bit of my vision, 2 weeks ago I just submitted a proposal which exactly addresses this. So this is one of the largest strawberry producers in the UK. We have also a company involved in the partner which tries to make this money clear that way you want to automate the food chain. It's one of the strawberries. There the project focus is between 4 and 5 million euros in sum, 8 partners involved, 4 years runtime. And Bandai should be the first prototype to do that. Just, of course, we're asking for a complete
time. Yeah, sure. Okay. But this is not something you feel we should do in Finland. It can also be cucumber.
I mean,
it can also be.
I don't say I'm against it, not at all, but right now we are not in the process of opening out and trying to find new application areas. But it's definitely an interesting one. They're far from interesting in trying to address it.
Yeah. Because if you ask me there, I see the largest potential for robots, to be honest.
Yeah. Sure.
Not in the typical agricultural crops that you have. Because then you will still have the tractor, and then it's better to think of emitting that rather than, say, additional robots.
Right. Yeah.
But
it's done. Okay. So, thanks a lot.